Good evening, everyone. Good evening, and thank you for coming to this last event in this year's Research Group on Constitutional Studies lecture series. The Research Group on Constitutional Studies brings together scholars in political theory, political science, philosophy, and law from across the university who study questions about the ideals, principles, and institutions that animate political and social orders. RGCS encompasses faculty and postdoctoral researchers, a program of doctoral fellows in residence, and a student fellowship for master's and undergraduate scholars. The Research Group on Constitutional Studies lecture series, supported by a generous gift to McGill from the Aurea Foundation, aims to bring leading researchers and scholars working on questions of the values, institutions, and principles of a free society to McGill in a way that makes their research broadly accessible to a student audience, thereby making clear at the student level how much intellectual work can be done at the leading research edge of debating those questions of values, institutions, and principles. RGCS is in turn, as of this year, a component unit of the Jan P. Lin Center for the Study of Freedom and Global Orders in the Ancient and Modern Worlds, supported by an additional gift to McGill from Jan P. Lin, PhD, class of 1992. The Lin Center will bring together normative and historical research from across the social sciences, allowing a site at McGill for humanistic social inquiry, ranging from the study of comparative and global antiquities and ancient history to the study of democracy and technology and how science shapes society today. The Jan Lin Center has a number of component research clusters, including RGCS, but the center as a whole will be inaugurated with a lecture on April 13th in this building at 4:30 p.m. that will be given by Orlando Patterson, John Cole's professor of sociology at Harvard University, who will speak on contestation and freedom in the making of Western culture, from the ancient Greeks to America's Tea Party. And I invite everyone here to please join us for that inaugural lecture, Wednesday, April 13th at 4:30. For today, we're very happy to conclude the RGCS lecture series for the year, as we have done on two previous occasions, with a debate between leading visiting scholars. We are joined this evening by Eric Mack and by Cécile Fabre. Eric Mack is professor of philosophy and a professor in the Murphy Institute at Tulane University. He's the author of John Locke, and the editor of collections of works by Oberon, Herbert, and Herbert Spencer. His primary philosophical interests are in the foundations of moral rights, property rights, and distributive justice, and the legitimate scope of coercive institutions. He has received grants and support from the National Endowment for the Humanities, the Earhart Foundation, the Center for Social Philosophy and Policy, and the Bradley Foundation. Cécile Fabre is senior research fellow at All Souls College and professor of political philosophy at Oxford University. She has held teaching appointments and chairs at the University of Edinburgh, at the London School of Economics, and at Worcester College, Oxford. She has been prize research fellow at Nuffield College, Oxford, and was trained at York, Oxford, and the Sorbonne. She's the author of numerous books, Social Rights Under the Constitution, Whose Body Is It Anyway? Justice and the Integrity of the Person, Justice in a Changing World, Cosmopolitan War, and the forthcoming Cosmopolitan Peace. Among her numerous honors, she is one of the youngest philosophers, and I believe the youngest woman philosopher ever admitted to the British Academy. Please join me in welcoming our guests for the evening, Eric Mack and Cécile Fabre.
Thank you, Jacob. It's everyone knows they're supposed to say what a pleasure it is to be here, and often people mean, it's okay to be here, but I'm delighted to be here, I really am. Cécile and I have had some exchanges already, and I know it's going to be a fun evening. Professor Fabre, who will forever from now on be referred to as Cécile, and I disagree about more than a few things. Our disagreement ranges from our moral judgments about specific cases to our views about what sort of background principles ought to be applied for making judgments in particular cases. One of the striking things is how much we agree upon what sorts of principles yield what sorts of particular judgments, which makes our discussion interesting. I want to put a little bit more flesh on this bare bones description of our disagreement by describing a specific case and indicating the opposing judgments that Cécile and I offer or tend to offer in these cases and the contrasting principles that inform our respective judgments. I will then go on to say something in support of my judgments and my principles. I want to emphasize that in the next several paragraphs, or even in the whole of these initial remarks, I'm not at all speaking for Cécile in characterizing an opposing view, and I'm certainly not in any way reporting on the nuances of her position. I don't intend anything I say in these opening remarks to be a specific criticism of her views. I'm trying to lay out basically these two rather fundamentally different approaches to making judgments in certain sorts of cases. Cécile holds, at least sometimes, and the sometimes is where a lot of the nuances come in, that if Joe needs a nice, healthy kidney in order to survive, and if Jane has two nice, healthy kidneys, and can make do pretty well with just one, then Joe has a right that Jane surrender one of those kidneys to him. Correlatively, Jane has an obligation to supply one of those kidneys. It's not merely right on this alternative view that I'm characterizing in general. It's not merely a nice thing for Jane to submit to the surgical removal of one of her kidneys. It's obligatory for Jane. It's required by justice. And Joe has a right to receive the kidney. His rights would be violated if Jane were to decline to donate that kidney. What sort of background principle is supposed to support these sorts of judgments in, let's call it, a Cécile-like position? The sort of background principles are principles of distributive justice. And I want to talk just a little bit about what the character of such principles are. I'm going to argue that approaching these questions in terms of notions of distributive justice is a deep mistake. Principles of distributive justice are essentially comparative. Someone who thinks in terms of distributive justice may say, in and of itself, there's nothing unjust about Jane having two nice, healthy kidneys. And in and of itself, there's nothing unjust about Joe not having any healthy kidneys. But when you look at the joint fact that Jane has two healthy kidneys and Joe has none, you see a comparative or distributive injustice. It's that comparison, it's in the comparison that the injustice lies. For the friend of distributive justice, justice is fundamentally a matter of there being the right balance or division of good stuff, in this case, healthy kidneys, between, in this case, Jane and Joe. Therefore, principles of distributive justice depend upon the idea that we're in position to come up with an authoritative ranking of alternative available distributions. It's better. It's a better division of kidneys if both parties have one kidney than if one has two and one has one. I think that this is a mistaken approach because I think that we do not have available to us a method for ranking such alternative distributions. That's quickly, the distribution in which in which Joe has a kidney and Jane has a kidney is, of course, better for Joe than the one in which he doesn't have a kidney, but the distribution in which Jane retains both her kidneys is better for Jane. So we have two different sorts of judgments. We don't have an overall judgment which gives each party reason to favor one particular distribution. Rather than approaching issues in terms of distributive justice and the need to make judgments about which balance of distributions is better than the other, I think that the fundamental principles of justice concern what ways of treating people, what modes of interaction between people are permissible, and what modes of interaction are not permissible. I hope to explain what I mean by that a little bit as we go along. What principles of distributive justice are appealed to in, let's call it, the Cécile-like approach? It is not crude principles like healthy kidneys ought to be distributed equally, nor principles like happiness or autonomy ought to be distributed equally. I take the position that's somewhat on the table here to be something like this, and it'll take several sentences to explicate the position. If someone is below a certain threshold vis-a-vis what makes his life valuable and can be brought up to that threshold only by someone else losing some of what makes her life valuable, and that loss to the second party doesn't bring that person down to or below that threshold, then justice requires that the second party undergo that loss in order to raise the first party at least above the threshold. The first party has a right to that sacrifice on the part of the second party. The second party has an obligation to volunteer or to accept or not to resist the imposition of that sacrifice upon her. Okay. So as I say, I reject this type of approach, and the central slogan of my rejection, it's not the bedrock foundation, but the central slogan is the proposition that, morally speaking, each individual has robust rights over his or her own person. Each individual has the right to dispose of his or her person, that is to say, his or her body, talents, powers, energies, effort, as he or she chooses, as long as her actions do not violate a comparable right in others. The right that I've been describing is often labeled the right of self-ownership. The idea is simply that each person has the right to exercise discretionary control over herself, which is like the right that an owner of some extra personal object, like my tie, has over the tie. So the tie is mine. I get to wear it or not as I choose. I get to wave it around or not as I choose. I tie it in knots if I choose, and choose also not to tie it in knots. I can refuse you the right to tie it in knots, and so on. Similarly, I can wave myself around if I choose, and probably if I had the skill, I could tie myself in knots, or I can choose not to do those things. I have a right of discretionary control over myself. So my view is that this right of self-ownership defines the moral default position with respect to what we each may do with ourselves and what we may not do with others. We each begin with the right that others not pour, say, maple syrup on us, but of course, through our actions or through the actions of others, these rights can be changed. I can give you permission to pour the maple syrup. I might consent to you pouring maple syrup on me because I know how happy it'll make you, or I'm might consent because in return you'll give me the right to pour maple syrup on you, and that would make me very happy. The rights we're speaking are of said to be natural rights. I should insert here something about why these are not very mysterious sorts of things, but I don't have the opportunity at this point to do that. The main feature of a natural right is that these are rights that are not granted by society to people. They're not granted by the government to people. They don't depend upon agreements that people have made. They're not rights to having injuries compensated for. These are rights which, in the old language, people are born to. Not necessarily born with, but born to. The crucial thing about such rights also is that since they don't depend upon a grant by society or the government, there must be some feature about all beings who have these rights, all persons, in virtue of which people have rights. And this, of course, is a complicated question. I'd say that the crucial morally impressive fact about persons, which underwrites every person having these basic rights of self-ownership, is that each person's life is of separate and ultimate importance. Maybe each person's life and well-being. Each person's life and well-being stands as a separate end, which that particular individual has special reason to preserve and serve. As the old beer commercial used to say, and I miss this commercial, each of us only goes around once in life and so ought to live our lives with gusto. I've never really known exactly what gusto was, but it sounds very good. On this view, although each of our lives and well-being has equal moral standing, we are not born to serve one another's well-being. We are not born to devote our lives to some concatenation of everyone's good, which is declared to be the common social good. Our bodies, for instance, are not part of a public pool of body parts that are to be divvied up in a way that will most promote some common social good. However, we do have reason to recognize the equal moral standing of all individuals as beings with ultimate ends of their own. My view is that we recognize others as beings with ultimate ends of their own by not treating them as means to our ends, by not treating them as raw material that we may dispose of as we please, as we see fit. Okay. One way of arguing for a natural right of self-ownership consists in pointing out how many of the less general rights that almost everyone wants to affirm, they seem to be the rights which ought to be affirmed, if any fundamental rights ought to be affirmed, are fall under the more general umbrella of a right of self-ownership. So what are these somewhat less general rights? Absent very special provocation, we each have a right not to be killed. We each have a right not to be maimed. We each have a right not to be subject to assault. We each have a right not to be enslaved. We each have a right not to be kidnapped and locked up. What unites all of these moral rights is that they are each manifestations of the basic default right, self-ownership. They are each manifestations of the fact that we are each properly in control of our own person, our own lives, and therefore we are each bound not to deprive others of their discretionary control over themselves. In some ways, one can best convey the force and the character of this idea of an original self-ownership right by talking about particular horrible examples of human mistreatment. Unfortunately, there's no shortage of these examples. One that I've used on some other occasions, and I'll use in a truncated form here, is the horrible activities of a man named Ariel Castro in Cleveland, Ohio, about a decade or more ago. Between 2002 and 2004, this man kidnapped three young women, kept them chained up and locked in his basement, beat them, raped them, threatened them with death. One of the women became pregnant several times, and through starvation and even more extensive beating, he caused miscarriages. Finally, one of the women escaped in 2013, and the other women were rescued. Just a nice, horrible example of human mistreatment. If we know anything at all about right and wrong, we know that Castro's actions were deeply wrong. We know what he did was morally intolerable, because it was a profound violation of the rights of these young women. These rights include, of course, the ones I've just mentioned earlier, the natural right against assault, a natural right not to be kidnapped, not to be maimed, not to be enslaved. I want to draw one further point from this horrible example. And this goes back to the difference between the sort of rights approach that I have and the distributive justice approach. The point is that the wrongfulness of Castro's treatment of these women resided in the manner in which he treated them, in his mode of interaction with them, and not in how the gains and losses of his action were distributed between the two of them. The moral criminality of Castro's conduct consisted in the multiple violations of the rights of these women to discretionary control over themselves, rather than his violation of any norm of distributive justice. This is a little tricky point to make because, of course, I'm not denying the horribleness. I'm affirming the horribleness of his behavior. It's a question of what the right analysis of the wrongfulness of the behavior is. Of course, so every theory, every proposition, principle of distributive justice that I've ever heard expressed condemns what Castro did on the basis of, but on the basis of what the distribution of costs and benefits were of what he did, right? Castro maybe pleased himself a little bit. He overcame what he testified was his sexual, he was a sex addict and he had these pangs of sexual deprivation. He managed to overcome that a little bit, get some relief from those pangs of sexual frustration by doing these horrible things to the woman. On any principle of distributive justice, the distribution of gains and losses were not appropriate to justify his actions. And of course, I'm not saying that they were. The problem with the distributive justice explanation for the wrong of Castro's actions is that if we start shifting the gains and the losses, if we modify the case sufficiently, we will still have Castro-like actions which satisfy whatever principle of distributive justice is put on the table, and therefore, according to that principle of distributive justice, the Castro-like actions will be acceptable, but of course, they will still remain unacceptable. So very briefly, a case to illustrate that. Imagine that Castro could have relieved his pangs of sexual frustration, terrible, which took away his ability to do anything else in his life. He could relieve those pangs for a year by once a year getting on a bus, sighting an attractive feminine shoulder, and quickly licking it. Just go up, lick this lady's shoulder, quickly get off the bus and run away, right? And he always licked the shoulder of women who, of course, found this yucky and weird, but they were non-fragile women and they got over it pretty quickly, right? Well, it looks as though on almost any sort of principle of distributive justice, when you apply that principle to this sort of case, the gains to Castro, that is relief from these terrible pangs of sexual frustration that he had, was vastly greater than the relatively minor losses to these non-fragile women. So if one takes this distributive justice approach to these sorts of cases, then there will be particular instances of Castro-like behavior that we'll have to judge as entirely justified. We'll have to say, perhaps, that Castro had a right to lick the shoulders of those women, that those women were obligated to present their lovely shoulders to Castro. My claim is that, of course, it doesn't follow from this at all, from these distributional effects, that what Castro did, or what this Castro-like person did, was justified. It was still clearly an abomination, still clearly something that he had no right to do, still clearly something that these women had every right to prevent happening. They were not in the least obligated to let Castro do this. But if our approach to these sorts of questions is based upon anything like the standard principles of distributive justice that people suggest, we're going to have to allow this modified Castro to lick those non-fragile women's shoulders. Thank you.
Right, so it's my turn to say with great sincerity that I'm delighted to be here in Montreal. I've always loved Montreal. It's my third visit to this city. It's always a pleasure for me to come back, but I have to say that It is a particular pleasure on this occasion for the following reason. The last time I was here was in 2000, and I gave two talks then, the first one of which was at the Université de Montréal. And that occasion stands out in my memory for three reasons. The first one was that because it was at the Université de Montréal, I had to do it in French, which I had never done before, you know, in philosophy, and it was hellishly difficult. I am deeply grateful that I don't have to use my mother tongue tonight to talk to you about those issues. The second reason why that talk stands out in my memory is because it was, in fact, the very first time that I had ever given or been invited to give a seminar on my work outside Britain. And so that's a very nice, you know, memory for me to have, to associate with Montreal. And the third reason is that then, in 2000, 16 years ago, the topic of my paper was the confiscation of life body parts. It was, in fact, the first time ever that I had tried out those ideas of which Eric spoke in public. And it is therefore particularly nice to come back 16 years later to talk once more in this city about the confiscation of life body parts. To prepare for this occasion tonight, I went back to my notes from 2000. I keep everything semi-neurotically. And I discovered that I still believe in most of what I wrote then, and I still feel shaken by some of the objections which were pressed against me at the time, and one of which, in particular, Eric pressed himself at the end of his remarks. I don't know whether to be comforted by the steadfastness of my intellectual commitments or depressed by what you might argue is a form of intellectual rigidity, but there you go. Now, as it happens, I haven't held on fast to everything I did say in 2000, and which I subsequently wrote in a book, Whose Body Is It Anyway?, which Jacob mentioned in his remarks. I have thought a little bit more about those issues on and off in the intervening years, and it seems to me that actually there are more points of agreement between Eric's views and mine today than I might have allowed a decade or so ago. So what I want to try and do in these remarks is to elucidate whether I can hold on to the view that under some circumstances at least, the able-bodied are under duties of justice to the non-able-bodied to provide them with assistance in the form of bodily organs, whether I can hold on to that view, but at the same time meet Eric, you know, halfway or even two-thirds of the way or three-quarters, you know, of the way. I will elucidate where I agree with him and why, and where I still disagree with him and why, but I should like to say that in the same way as his remarks I found were entirely, they were critical, but very constructively critical, I want to do the same. So if you have come here expecting an intellectual bloodbath, you will leave, you know, disappointed. I really want to treat this as a joint endeavor, you know, to get as far as possible, as close as possible to the truth of the matter. So let me briefly recap what Eric says in four simple steps. The first thing he says is this, that to argue as I do, that agents are sometimes under duties to make parts of their body available to those who need those parts, blood transfusions, you know, being the obvious example, to say that is to deny that we have robust rights of self-ownership. And such denial, second, comes at an enormous cost. It comes at the cost of not fully acknowledging that we are valuable and valued as persons, as having separate ends. As he puts it, we are not born to devote our lives to some concatenation of everyone's good. It comes at the cost of not being able properly to explain why someone like Ariel Castro wrongs his victims. Eric says that this particular wrongdoing has got nothing to do with distributive justice. It has everything to do with the respect we owe to one another as self-owning agents, and his criticism tonight is that I cannot say that and at the same time believe that agents are sometimes under a duty to make some of their body parts available to those who need those body parts. And finally, to hold that view, and in so doing to deny robust self-ownership rights, comes at the cost of not being able to say that we ought not to allow Castro to satisfy his sexual urges by quickly licking the shoulder of a young woman once a year. Now, these are really powerful challenges. I think I can go somewhere towards meeting them all, but I have to say that I do have a difficulty with sex in this particular context. The objection that he presses there is one that has often been pressed against my view, and it is the one which I might as well say it outright is the most problematic for my kind of argument. So let me outline where I agree with Eric and where I disagree and why. And let me begin with what is at the core of his moral and political philosophy, namely the notion of self-ownership. Eric claims, as many as those have claimed, that we, that is to say moral agents, have very strong rights of ownership over our body, our person, our labor, and by extension over the fruits of our labor. Now, in the book that I wrote on this material, Whose Body Is It Anyway?, I defend the limited confiscation of body parts. And in that book, I do not take a stand on whether or not the rights that we have over ourselves are appropriately characterized as rights of ownership. In the relevant literature, there is a lively debate as to whether or not it makes sense even to talk self-reflectively about self-ownership rights. I don't take a stand on this in the book, and 10 years after the book came out, I still think I don't need to take a stand on this. I'm actually very happy to accept that those rights that we have over our body and our person are aptly described as rights of self-ownership. I don't think that what I argue in the book and what I still think depends on accepting or denying the truth of this particular claim. Eric says, I quote, each individual has the right to dispose of his or her person, of his or her body, talents, powers, energy, and effort as he or she chooses, as long as her actions do not violate the like rights of others. Now, I emphasize like in the like rights of others. Eric thinks, at least I think he thinks, that only rights which constrain self-ownership rights are self-ownership rights themselves. So to put it in a phrase which I lift directly from the writing of Jerry Cohen, one of the most distinguished critics, perhaps the most distinguished critics of self-ownership, my right to use my fist stops at your nose. So I may have rights of ownership over my fist, but those rights of ownership are constrained by your rights of ownership over your nose, such that I don't have the right to use my fist to punch you in the nose unless you give me a good reason, so to do. But pending, absent such reason, then my right of ownership over my fist is limited by your right of ownership over your nose. So the question, is this. When we say that the only rights which constrain self-ownership rights are self-ownership rights themselves, we might mean two different things. And I do not know, it's a genuine question, I do not know which of those two things Eric actually has in mind. He might think that there are rights other than rights of self-ownership, or indeed other than rights derived from the exercise of self-ownership rights. You might think that not all the rights that we have flow from rights of self-ownership, but that nevertheless, rights of self-ownership always override rights of non-self-ownership. Or he might think, on the contrary, that the only rights that we have are rights of self-ownership, or rights which derive from the exercise of our self-ownership rights. And if that is the case, well, it clearly is, it seems, the case, true, that rights of self-ownership are sovereign, if you will. Now, it seems to me that that last interpretation, the claim, in other words, that we have no rights which are not rights of self-ownership, or rights that we derive from our exercise of self-ownership, that first interpretation seems to me to be implausible, or at least it would rule out certain rights which many people regard as quite important, in particular rights of inheritance. I don't mean the right to bequeath a right to be quiz can easily be described as a right deriving from self-ownership. I mean the right to inherit, the right to accept a bequeath. I don't quite see how one can describe that right as a right flowing from my exercise of rights of self-ownership. And I also believe, though Eric might deny this, that we do have basic assistance rights. I do believe, I'm not going to argue for this tonight, I don't have the time, but I do believe that, you know, I do have a right to food, such that if I'm going to starve unless I get food, then third parties who have surpluses of food are under a very strong duty, which correlates with my right, to give me that surplus of food. Perhaps Eric agrees with me. Perhaps, repeat, he thinks that we do have rights which are not rights of self-ownership or rights which are derived from our rights of self-ownership. Perhaps he agrees that I do have a right to food, but he might nevertheless insist that my right to food can never override your right over your own body. And that, I think, is also implausible, or at least I would disagree with it. It does seem to me that in some cases at least, if we have a right of assistance which can be respected only if other people lack the freedom to dispose of their body as they wish, then so be it. Those people are under a duty to use their body as demanded by my exercise of my right to assistance. To give you an example, I do believe, for example, that we have a right to be spared from avoidable drowning. If I do walk, it's a very familiar example, but I'll meet it. Describe it anyway. If I do walk past a shallow pond and I'm a very good swimmer and I see that someone is at risk of drowning and I can rescue that person at very, very little cost to myself, then I am, in my view at any rate, under very strong duty so to act. That person has a right against me that I so act. This, of course, if true, is tantamount to saying that I do not in that moment have a right of self-ownership. I do not have the right to use my body as I want. I do not have the right, for example, to move my legs in such a way that I will walk away from the pond without rescuing that person. One way to characterize our disagreement on this is this. He and I agree, I think, that individuals have self-ownership rights, but we disagree as to how robust those rights actually are. And the case of bodily organs is an acute, nice example of a disagreement about the robustness of those rights. Eric thinks that there are limits to the sacrifices that we can be expected to make for the sake of others, and divesting ourselves of our body parts is one such limit. I fully agree with him that we are not born to devote our lives to some, I quote, I like that phrase, so I'm going to quote it again, some concatenation of everyone's good. In fact, I fully agree that we should live our life with gusto. Gusto does sound good. It really does. So here is the key question. Can I agree with Eric that really we ought to have the opportunity to live our life with gusto, and yet maintain that in some cases, at least, we are under a duty, a strong duty of justice, to make parts of our body available to those who need them. Now, here is very briefly how I argue for the confiscation of live body parts. And in fact, the same applies, a fortiori, to the mandatory taking of cadaveric organs. The argument very briefly goes like this. If we accept that the well-off, the monetarily well-off, if you will, are under duties of justice to distribute some of their material resources via taxation to the needy, then by parity of reasoning, we must accept that the able-bodied are under duties of justice to distribute parts of their body, as well as personal services, for that matter, to the non-able-bodied, ceteris paribus. The fact that there are differences between money on the one hand and body parts on the other hand are not such as to undermine the analogy. Now, I'm not going to go through the whole argument here. I don't have the time to do it. But I do want to stress one absolutely vital point. On the view of justice, which I develop in that book and in some other writings, I argue that we do enjoy a personal prerogative not to help others at the cost of our own prospects for a flourishing life. So that if donating a kidney would come at that cost, then we are not under a duty to do so. And likewise, I argue with donating blood, donating bone marrow, donating a liver lobe, and so on and so forth. So there is no question of devoting our lives, you know, to someone else. So I really agree, you know, with Eric on this particular point. There is a limit to the sacrifices that we can demand of people that they should incur, you know, for the sake of justice. So I agree with him on that point, even if I get to that conclusion via a different route. But it is absolutely true that we still disagree on the following claim. On the argument that I try to develop, if donating a kidney, if donating blood, if donating a liver lobe would not violate or undermine my prospects for a flourishing life, then prima facie, I would be under a duty of justice to make it available to someone who might need it. Now, Eric thinks that this kind of argument really cannot explain what's wrong about Aya Castro's treatment of the three women he kidnapped, raped, beat up in the course of over a decade. I fully agree with Eric that considerations of distributive justice are not the right way to think about these particular cases. In fact, I fully agree with him that the wrongdoing committed by Castro lies in not respecting those women's rights to control their body. So here's the key question. Can I agree with Eric on this and yet maintain to repeat that in some cases at least, we are under a duty to make some of our body parts available to those who need them? Now, when I started thinking and writing about this, I wasn't fully alive and attentive to the important point that I'm going to make now. And I'm grateful to Eric for forcing me to revisit this and for making me more aware of that point, you know, which is this, that considerations of distributive justice clearly do not exhaust, you know, morality. So even if it is true that in principle, it is possible, at least conceptually coherent, and in some cases normatively required, to speak of the provision of a body part or indeed of a personal service as something which, again, in principle, can be governed by norms of distributive justice. Even if that is true, it does not follow that everything that there is to be said, normatively speaking, about the provision or the withholding of those body parts of bodily services has to be couched by appeal, you know, to distributive justice. My concern in this part of my work is with the extent to which we have duties of assistance to those who need our help and the kind of assistance that we are under a duty so to provide. It is not with the duty not to harm. So I would like to suggest that it does make sense to speak of distributive justice when we have to speak about the allocation of goods and some services, but that locating the wrongfulness of grievous harm on others, such as the harm that Castro inflicted on those women, that locating that kind of wrongfulness requires looking at norms such as the fundamental respect that we owe, you know, to one another. The distributive justice is not the right way to go, you know, about this. Now, Eric is not, I think, going to be happy to let it rest at that. You know, he's going to say, well, look, you're not really answering the biggest of my challenge. Because suppose that we do have a conflict between those two values, the value of distributive justice on the one hand, and the value of owing respect to one another on the other hand. And suppose that we would satisfy distributive justice by infringing on someone's self-ownership rights, by failing to treat that person with the respect that they are owed. On what grounds can I say that in these particular cases, self-ownership rights override, you know, the value of distributive justice, given that I concede, in fact, strongly argue that in other such cases, I think that self-ownership has to give way. And this is where the example of Castro satisfying his urges by licking, you know, the shoulder of another woman, you know, comes in. As I mentioned a moment ago, that kind of example has often been pressed against me. Here is the response I gave 16 years ago. I reiterated it in writing 10 years ago, and I'm going to have another go today, knowing that it is a fairly feeble, you know, response. Though if you think it's a good one, please do let me know in the discussion. I do think that there is a difference between giving blood and offering or having one's shoulder used, you know, for sexual licking. That the former is not inherently objectifying of the person, whereas the latter is. And it seems to me that so long as one would satisfy distributive justice by insisting that a person allow herself to be treated as an object for the satisfaction of another person, then we ought not to do so. In other words, a prohibition on objectification would have to be incorporated in the personal prerogative to enjoy some of our most ends and important goals at the cost of helping others lead a flourishing life. I don't know whether the response work, but thinking about it again tonight with you has been enormous fun, for which I thank you. Thank you.
So here's the quandary I was having while I was sitting over there. I think I left my pen, which Cécile may have just taken.
Mine.
So I thought, would it be okay for me to take Cécile's pen without asking her permission?
I consent.
And I decided I shouldn't take her pen without her permission. Therefore, I didn't take notes, you see. let me start going backwards, okay, back in reverse order. It occurs to me right away that the commodification was it language of disrespect? I think once you go down that path, you make the same objection to required organ transplants, to required blood. You're treating people as though they are simply reservoirs or warehouses of resources that are going to serve other people's interests. So I don't think that, I think if one is going to go that way, that sounds fine to me, but I think it has the sort of implications that I would prefer rather than the ones that you may want to rescue. There's a lot of stuff about what do I think self-ownership is, and do I think there are other fundamental rights besides self-ownership, and what rights limit others. I don't want to try to get involved in that very much. I don't think that self-ownership rights are the only natural rights. But I do think, and of course there are lots of rights that people acquire which aren't natural rights that they get through contract, rights that they get as rights of restitution when harm is done to them, rights through other sorts of less formal understandings that people form with one another. And of course our rich world of obligations and rights towards one another very much develops out of all those sorts of forms of interaction. But I do think that absent something like contracts or absent something like you're having harmed me and therefore you have a positive obligation to make it up to me, absent that, people don't have positive rights against one another. And so my basic claim is that the only rights that people have against one another when they don't have these acquired rights that involve interactions of various sorts are negative and therefore don't extend to a right to rescue. I'm willing to bite that bullet. So I don't believe that people have a right to be rescued even when they can be easily rescued by somebody with whom they've had no previous interaction and so on. That extends to I don't believe that people have a right to a bit of food when they need that food in order to live. They don't even have that right against others who can readily supply them with food. How much of a bullet is that to bite? Well, I think it seems like an enormous bullet to a lot of people because a lot of people tend to have a highly politicized view about morality or a highly legalized view about morality. They think that to deny that I have a rights correlative obligation to help people is to deny that I have very good moral reasons for helping people, all right? I like to think, in fact, that I'm more likely to jump in the pool to save that person who's otherwise will drown than lots of people who believe in principles of distributive justice and principles of mandatory rescue. I think what's really, really important for political philosophers is to resist this tendency to think that every moral prescription that we make has to be cast in terms of people having obligations that are correlative with rights, which are in principle legally enforceable. The reason you don't want to do that, I think the reason that nobody or almost nobody in this room wants to do that, is you convert all moral disagreement into political disagreement, and every moral community therefore goes to war, goes to political war in order to capture the state and get the state to enforce their moral view, which they believe to be entirely cash-outable in terms of legally enforceable obligations and rights. I think that's a very bad, you kiss goodbye the prospect of a free and pluralistic liberal society if you endorse that. Once again, I want to emphasize that there are all sorts of good reasons people have to be decent people, and all sorts of good reasons that decent people have to operate in terms of benevolence and generosity and generalize goodwill towards other people, which very naturally leads to even crazed self-ownership people like myself readily jumping in and saving that kid, who I recognize, kid raises some other problems, but who I perceive as somebody who has a life of great importance for him and for other people. And so, of course, I'm going to do it. Good.
Okay, that's interesting. So I want to make two points. So I don't think that a commitment to the duty to give blood. So I have those two strong intuitions, and you know the problem for me is that I think that they can be made consistent. You don't think so, but I have that strong intuition that I'm under a very strong duty of justice, which under some circumstances can be appropriately enforced to give blood on a regular basis. But I don't have a strong duty of justice. In fact, I don't have a duty at all to allow my shoulder, you know, to be used, you know, for sexual, you know, licking. And I think that the only way, you know, to drive a wedge, you know, between, you know, those, you know, two things is to think a bit more about, you know, the status of one's body in relation, you know, to myself. And to repeat, I mean, I don't think of my blood as being inherently, you know, part of me. I don't really care about my blood other than as, you know, that which enables me, you know, to stay alive. But I care, and I would wager that most people care very deeply, you know, about their sexuality, whether or not, you know, they are sexually active. You know, our sexuality generally, whether or not we are sexually active, is bound up with our sense of ourselves, you know, as a person, you know, in a way that, you know, the various drops of blood that together make up the whole of our blood, you know, isn't. So I think that's how I would hope to continue to be able to, you know, distinguish, you know, the two positions. But again, you know, there is a whiff of ad hocness, you know, about this, and I'm not very happy with that. So I need help from you, you know, to make the argument stronger. The bullet that you are biting, to turn to your second point, is a really, 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 really big bullet, you know, to bite. I mean, I suppose, so I have two questions for you. The first one is a question of clarification. So I wasn't clear whether your view is that, you know, we do actually have, you know, obligations to help the needy. Those obligations, one, do not correlate with rights, two, are not unforeseeable, or whether your view is that we merely have reasons, you know, which fall short of obligations, you know, to help the very needy. I think those are two very different positions, and I would quite like to know more, to know what you think there. The third point I want to make, it's a question, really. So you agree that there are principles of rectification? You know, of course you do. So if I harm you, if I violate your rights of self-ownership, I owe you, you know, some compensation. Now, Judith Thompson, in one of her articles, makes the following point, you know, which even I, with the views I hold, find really, really difficult to swallow. And I'm curious to know what your response will be. She says, well, imagine someone who deliberately, culpably, tries to kill another person for no justifiable reason. And he fails. However, he leaves his victim in such a state that she needs a heart transplant. Lo and behold, the attacker is a match. Does his duty of compensation, in fact, include a duty to make his heart available to that victim? And let's suppose that it's the only way she can survive. Of course, he will die, clearly. Now, she thinks, yes. You know, she thinks that, you know, the logic, if you will, of rectification is such that this is one instance where we don't have very robust rights, you know, of our own body. And I would really love to know what you think about this particular case.
Good. Nice. Yes, absolutely. There is that duty. I wouldn't expect anyone of that sort to willingly comply with it, and therefore I think it can be enforced on that person.
Wow.
Absolutely. I think in my answer to the reason versus obligations, without being trying to be too cute about the terminology, I think my answer is reasons but not obligations.
Okay.
Let's see. Oh, my gosh, there was another point I wanted to respond to. Do I have another minute?
You have a minute and a half.
You know, the main point I wanted to make, I think I've... Oh, this is a point I do want to make. I think that we haven't discussed at all one thing that should go into a discussion of what sort of rights people have and what sort of obligations other people have. And that is the immediate implication that if somebody has a right against me, it is at least in principle enforceable. Because we then shift the picture from the niceness of the person complying with the purported right to the ugliness of what you have to do if the person declines to. So even in the case of the rescue, right, of the it's one thing to notice the ugliness of somebody not engaging in the rescue. It adds something to our picture and might change our view about whether there's a right to be rescued if we think about what we then may do to the person who we've asserted has that obligation. Punish them afterwards, grab them, put a gun at their head to make sure that they jump in the water. So I think it's a big mistake to segregate the picture of how people would act if only they would comply with this particular act, which is always going to be a pleasant thing to envision, from what we would have to do to them or what it would be acceptable to do to them if they're not so eager to perform the action. And if we're not eager to do that, then we have to rescind our claim that there's a right.
Can I move
the microphone?
No, you still have your 2 minutes.
Oh, all right. No, I do. Okay, good. So the last point is really important, I think, about how we are going to enforce, you know, those duties. Now, in many legal systems, there is no legal requirement of specific performance. So, you know, assume that which may, I don't know, be close to the truth, that by accepting this invitation to speak today, I place myself under a quasi-contractual obligation to turn up, you know, and deliver, you know, this talk. Now, if I had breached that contractual obligation, if I had said, well, actually, you know what, I've got a better offer since, you know, to go to University of Toronto. It's a much better gig. So I'm going to go to Toronto and not to Montreal. I mean, it wouldn't have been possible for you guys, you know, to physically compel me, you know, to turn up here. But you might have, you know, wanted to sue me, you know, under torts law, you know, for example. That there is a case in English law of a singer who decamped to another theatre in London halfway through a run of performance because that other theatre was paying her better. And the judge actually said, well, I'm not going to force her to sing, you know, for you lot, but I'm going to force her to compel her to pay damages. And so I would want to go down that route, you know, when I speak of the enforceability of duties to perform inner services. But I think you're right, it's something that we need to talk about more, you know, generally in that territory. Is that okay? Do you want me to move the mic?
Because
I think...
I'll take the first question.
Oh, I see. Okay.
It is our norm at the RGCS lectures that the first question is reserved for a member of the Research Group on Constitutional Studies student fellowship. So I'll take the first question, then I'll hand the microphone over and you can call on people. So a member of the student fellowship, please.
And you lose the fellowship if you don't.
It's too late in the year for that to... Yes.
Lives would be just, that much better if they could have a child, but they were physically unable to have the child themselves. And let's say that there was someone else who it would, you know, for some reason they're just so nice and it wouldn't be such a big deal for them to have the child for the other person. So I guess the body part would be, you know, they would loan their uterus for 9 months. Do you think that there's an obligation to provide assistance with surrogacy in some cases?
Yeah. That's a very, very good question, which I try to address it in the book, you know, as well. And I conclude that in the end, there is no duty. You're giving me the easy case. You know, the easy case is the provision of the womb. And the reason why I think there is no duty is that, you know, even if you think that it's not that big a deal, nevertheless, you know, pregnancy and childbirth are still dangerous. You know, you can die. But short of death, you know, you can incur fairly serious, you know, disabilities, and it seems to me that the risk thereof is high enough that you shouldn't be held under a duty to do so. You can also never know, actually, in advance how you are going to feel about having to relinquish the child, and then we get into very difficult, you know, issues to do. Well, would you be placed under a duty to relinquish the child, you know, and so on and so forth. So, for those reasons, I say no. The harder case is the provision of eggs, of gametes. That's not dangerous, you know, in the way that pregnancy and childbirth, you know, are. But then you have another minefield, you know, to do with the welfare of the child, you know, who might want to know that he or she has been adopted, who might want to trace, you know, his or her natural birth mother. And again, I mean, it seems to me that the complications are such, you know, that, I mean, in the end, I don't think that one can be under duty, you know, so to act. But you're right, that's the other difficult, possibly difficult implication of our argument.
I guess it's more of a comment than a question, but there's a sense in which it's going to end with a question mark, I guess. So I'm not against the confiscation in principle of body parts. I think blood are good examples, but I'm just not sure that if we're going to go the distributive justice way, that the problems is best cashed out in these one-off sort of situations in which one person needs one good and they have a right against one person, or one person has an obligation. In most liberal civilized countries, health services are provided by the state, or at least are organized or funded by the state, and it seems that the right to of people would be of Joe in the first example would be against the state to provide the conditions in which they will have the health services that they need. Now I know, it has to be taken into account that cadaveric, I guess, organs are not enough to supply for the demand, and that what's the word for when you just give out your organs altruistically are not enough for the demand either. So wouldn't it be better to understand the problems in terms of the right of Joe to have the state putting in the proper services and the proper means to actually satisfy the demands for organs. So it could be through donations, it could be through promotion of donations, it could be through promotion of signing your card to actually give your organs when you die. It could be through some sort of compensatory programs, or it could be even through enforceable confiscation. But it seems that that thinking of the right against the state instead of the person who has that kidney is a better way to do it.
My immediate reaction early on was that it's false that the state provides it. The state acquires its resources from citizens. And so the obligations, you're going to have to establish the obligation on the part of the citizens to be subject to what the state is going to do to them or with them in order to fulfill its supposed obligation. So I don't think you get systematically away from the problem of whether the citizens as individuals have these obligations.
To pay taxes, you mean?
Pardon?
To pay just taxes in general?
Sure, or whatever the system turns out to be part of the state system of the collection of organs or whatever.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, I completely agree, you know, with that.
One thing I think is interesting to bring up is the market alternative, right? Especially if you think that people whose contributions are required nevertheless ought to receive compensation for that. If you think that, it's not going to take much more than barely compensating them to get people to volunteer. Now, then there's the question of where the funds come, right? But it looks like you could circumvent the need for the evil of coercion by having a system in which whoever is managing the system is acquiring the organs or the cells or whatever by voluntary purchase from the people who supply it. Then you just have a much neater, much cleaner system, morally speaking.
Yeah, you do. So I think that's interesting. You do, except that there will be cases where not enough people are willing to sell. That's point number one. And so the question is, well, what do we do in those cases? Point number two, it's related, but there are cases where people will be willing to sell, but they will only be able to do so posthumously, as it were, with their heart, in a post-mortem. So in order to say that that's an acceptable, way to proceed, then you have to have a theory of the extent to which you will allow inheritance, rights, and the proceeds of those sales, to go to the heirs, of the people who have posthumously sold, their heart, two kidneys, liver, lungs, and so on and so forth. I think,
That sounds quite desirable to me. Can I say briefly that that if you have a situation where not enough people are willing to sell, right, mm-hmm. then you have a situation in which you're not even coming close to compensating people. If you provide particular individuals with more than would compensate them, not necessarily very much more, then they're willing to sell.
Right, but if you don't think that compensation is owed, in those cases, then that's not really a problem. Then you're not going to worry that you're not coming close to compensate people. You have to ask, well, not enough people, willing to sell. We do have people who die every year because they lack, there is a shortage of, kidneys, liver, cornea, blood, in fact. What do we do? Do we compel? And my view is that under some, in fact, limited circumstances, it's appropriate to compel. So that's the disagreement between us.
The first thing that you do is to actually see whether a market works, because you don't have to coerce people. That's at least the first thing that you try. I don't know the numbers, right, but I've heard it said that the United States, scores of thousands of people die every year from non-availability of kidneys. And it looks like you would substantially solve that problem with a market.
So that, yeah, that's interesting. So I think I would be willing, you know, to go down that route. There are worries about, well, you might not share those worries, but, you know, there are worries about exploitation, you know, which have to be addressed. But if we can block, you know, those worries, and then if we can also agree on some price capping, you know, for example. So, you know, we don't want to be in a situation where, you know, some people simply don't have the means, you know, to buy, you know, the relevant organs. So you would have to have a system whereby, and actually that ties in with your point before we move on to someone else, you would have to have a system whereby the state, you know, buys, you know, those organs from, you know, people willing to sell and then distributes them, you know, on the basis of need. So that would be one way, you know, to, one way to do it.
Great. Thanks very much, first of all, for a really interesting debate. I'd like to sort of follow up on the first question asked, but take it in a different direction, which I'm kind of surprised no one has brought in yet. So with respect to what seem to be really asymmetrical gendered implications of Professor Fobb's view, I'm wondering how this would work for abortion cases. Obviously, you have the first possible set of answers, which is simply to claim the fetus is not a person in any moral sense with rights. But that's obviously a contested view. So it seems that as soon as you get into something where the fetus might have rights, where the mother is the only person who can provide what is necessary for the fetus's interest, you have a weird policy. I mean, I guess you brought up Judith Jarvis Thompson and her violinist abortion article. Seems relevant here. So I'm wondering if you could speak to that.
Yeah, so good. So that's another very good example. So I don't think that, I really do not think that there is a duty to remain pregnant, you know, even if the fetus is a person, you know, right from the moment of conception, you know, for the reasons that that I gave earlier. I mean, you know, pregnancy and childbirth are extraordinarily dangerous. I mean, we, you know, in our countries, you know, we tend to forget that because most of them actually go well. But in fact, they can go very, 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 very badly indeed, you know, even in highly developed, industrialized, you know, medicalized, you know, countries such as Canada, you know, the United States, France, you know, and Britain. I think that the really, really difficult question, I've written a little bit about this, is this. If it were possible to transfer a fetus onto an artificial womb, you know, very early on in the pregnancy, and if the medical risks of so doing, you know, were really, really negligible, you know, would a mother be under, would a woman, you know, be under a duty to allow, you know, this to happen should her partner wish, you know, the baby to be brought, you know, to term and bring the baby, you know, to term? And, you know, I think in some cases I might want to answer yes, you know, to that question. But as long as the fetus is in the woman's body and as long as the risks of childbirth and pregnancy as are what they are, and there is no reason to say that they're going to diminish, you know, drastically in years to come, then I would not want, you know, to say that there is a duty to be a good Samaritan, you know, in such cases, which is, you know, Judith Thompson's, you know, phrase.
I think if you're going to...
Go ahead.
I was just going to say, yeah, if we're going to be fact sensitive, right, to decide whether there's actually a duty here, depending on what the prospective expected costs are, you might be committed to looking at particular cases. And yeah, is there a danger here? Well, yes, so this woman isn't under a duty. But is there a danger in this other case? Much less of a danger as far as we can tell, and so that person does fall under the duty. And I don't think you can be fact sensitive on one level without being prepared
to be
fact sensitive.
So, but I do think that, I do think, and I've looked at the facts that, you know, even a pregnancy that goes well, you know, even a childbirth which, as it starts, you know, goes well, you know, there always will be a risk that the woman will die, you know, of preeclampsia, for example, of, you know, blood loss, you know, that cannot be stopped. There is always a risk that, you know, the woman will, for example, suffer incontinence, you know, for years to come, you know, even in countries, you know, such as ours. Now, you know, if the facts turn out to be wrong, then I suppose, One would have to look at, you know, whether or not that ties back to the issue of artificial wombs. You know, whether we can ask of someone that she should live with the knowledge that a child of his or hers exists, you know, out there in the world, you know, whose existence, you know, she has not in fact consented to. And we might think that that's too high a price to pay, you know, for someone. You know, I might be wrong about this, and the facts might turn out to be such that, you know, the risks of pregnancy combined with childbirth are as low to someone as the risk of whatever harm might befall you if you give blood, you know, once a year. If that turned out to be the case, and if, in other words, I would have to go to put the two acts, you know, on a par, then I think that's the point at which I would side with Eric. I would say that there are, you know, certain things, you know, which are not amenable to norms, you know, of distributive justice, and whether or not you have your body invaded or taken up, as it were, you know, by another organism, you know, so having your body so occupied is one of the things over which you have to consent, or to which, you know, you have to consent. You know, for reasons to do with, you know, what a fetus is, which blood isn't. But again, perhaps it's too ad hoc, but I find it very hard to believe that we could ever end up with a situation where bringing a child to term, you know, would be as negligible as giving a pint of blood once a year for the sake of saving someone's life. I just find it very, very hard, you know, to fathom, you know.
We have a lot of people on the queue.
So we'll try to be quicker.
Yes, my question is to Professor Fabre. I would like to clarify the argument you offered in support of your view. So you said that if we accept that we can redistribute resources from the wealthy to the less wealthy, then by parity of reason, we would have equivalent reasons to do the same with organs. And I'd like to understand more the first part of the analogy you draw here, because there are various reasons why we think that we can transfer resources from the wealthy to the less wealthy. So we might have a conception of political society where we see society as a cooperative enterprise, and then on that basis we think that we can redistribute income. But then we've built something in the argument, and it seems to me that the analogy breaks down. And so I just like clarification on this.
Good. I don't have that view of distributive justice, you know, as, you know, a set of principles for the allocation of burdens and benefits resulting from, you know, social cooperation. You know, I think of justice as being, you know, pre-institutional, you know, certainly. That's the first point. The second point is that, you know, even if we should conceive of, you know, justice or principles of justice as flowing from an understanding of social interaction, which is essentially cooperative, I don't see why we can't really formulate principles for the allocation of body parts in the same way as, you know, we form of organs. The argument that I'm trying to make very briefly goes like this. Suppose we accept that there is a duty to provide money, you know, to those, you know, who need it. Well, a lot of people, you know, do need body parts, you know, in order to survive, indeed in order to have, you know, a flourishing life. And as I try to show in the book, the differences that there are, you know, between money on the one hand and parts of the body on the other hand are not morally salient, you know, in such a way that there could be a duty to give money on the one hand but no duty to give blood, you know, on the other hand. So it is true that, you know, my blood is inside my body, but I don't see why that should be vindictive, you know, or rather, I don't see why that should decisively, if you will, tell against, you know, a duty to give blood, you know, given that it is a sense in which it's a resource, given that it can be extracted from my body in the same way as my money can be extracted from my bank account, and given that it is needed, you know, by some people as a matter of life and death. So that's roughly how, you know, the argument goes. I mean, Eric is right to emphasize that, I mean, he doesn't think that there is a right of assistance. And, you know, if you're with him on that point, then you don't even get to board my boat, my ship, you know, as it were. So the key question is what follows, you know, from the view that there is a right, you know, of monetary, you know, assistance. If you don't accept that, then I think, you know, Eric is on very strong, solid footing, you know, to reject, you know, the kind of argument that I make. Well, yeah, though you do so for different reasons.
Yeah. Yeah. If you start with the rejection of the body part redistribution, right?
Yes.
You accept that if you endorse the taxation, you have to endorse the redistribution, then you infer that you should change your mind about the taxation.
Can you run this by me again?
Well, the argument can go both ways, right?
It could go.
Yes. Of course, the taxation is fine. The taxation is fine, then the redistribution of body parts is fine. Yeah. So we have that second premise.
Yeah,
if you accept the second premise, but you reject the redistribution of body parts, then you slip back to denying the legitimacy of the taxation.
Yeah. So
and that's I just say that because the standard old libertarian argument
was
if you accept the tax accepts that second premise. If you accept the taxation, then you have to accept the body part.
Yeah. So Eric and I agree on something which is, I think, very, very important, and so we both together disagree with, you know, left egalitarian liberals such as Rawls and Dworkin. You know, they think that you can say yes, you know, to taxation and no to the body. And Eric and I both think that the two stand or fall, you know, together. Fine. We also agree on commodification. I mean, you know, I have, you know, odd views for liberals about, you know, the right to sell, you know, body parts under some circumstances. But I think that's a key point of agreement between us that, you know, we think that they stand or fall, you know, together. We disagree with Dworkin, who says, quote, we should draw a prophylactic line around the body and not make it part of social resources at all.
Nearly differ on whether it rises or falls.
That's a crucial disagreement. Yeah, good.
So my question is also for Professor Favre. So if we accept that there is an enforceable obligation to donate kidneys, for instance, how do we specify who that obligation can be enforced against? Because presumably every possible donor has an equal obligation. So the second part of my question is, in specifying that principle, don't we also run the same kind of risk of introducing exploitation that we might in opening up a market? Because, for instance, you could make the argument that, say, well, criminals, right, they owe somebody something. Maybe they should be at the top of the list of people who owe possible obligations, in which case, right, you've already got discrimination on class and race there.
Yeah, I think that's a very good point. The point about criminals, a lot would depend on whether or not imagining the view where we have those people in prison. They're there, they're captive, actually, in some important sense. So we're going to go to them to check whether they are that they are compatible, you know, donors. And I would really disagree with that. I think it's a very interesting question as to whether or not we ought to give a criminal the rightfully the choice, you know, between serving, you know, a term in prison on the one hand and donating a kidney, you know, on the other hand. I haven't thought about this, so I don't have firm views there. But if you're worried about discrimination, then, you know, the best way to do it is by lottery. Because then you give, you know, everyone, you know, stands the same risk, you know, of being selected. You know, that's the egalitarian way of doing it, you know, it seems to me. But that's a good question. I have to think more about that.
Yes, I have a question for Eric Mack. It seems that given what Cecile said, she can avoid some of the judgments that you deem unacceptable, at least some of them, by toning down the status of the requirements of distributive justice. So if I understand Cecile, she takes them to be pro tanto requirements that has to be weighed against and sometimes even perhaps constrained by other normative considerations, some of which may be very important for you. Now, shouldn't you do a parallel move? or are you so absolutistic about your negative right of self-ownership? Are you not ready to take that right to be sometimes outweighed by some positive duties of assistance? So if, for example, Cecile is sleepwalking towards the window and she will fall and die, and there's no waking her up, right? So the only way to stop her is for you to stop her. And I tell you, stop, put your body in between Cecile and the window. And you say, no, I won't do it. Would it be unacceptable for me to push you so that your body stops her body. That would be to violate your self-ownership rights. But am I not entitled to do that? It seems to me that the intuitive answer is to say, I'm surely entitled to do that. And that shows that your negative self-ownership right is not more than a protanto right. If you say no to this, then you have to bite a really big bullet, or actually Cécile will have to bite it with her life. Or the drowning person. The ones biting the bullet are the people dying. No, yes. That's not to be forgotten.
So despite all the talk of my generosity, it's Cécile who's being generous and not me. So there's things are more complicated, right, than our brief remarks allowed. And the main thing I would say is that a person who is in danger of dying is at liberty to, say, take the food that he needs. Can't be obligated not to take the food that he needs. And that somebody, that others, that third parties can act on behalf of that person and exercise that liberty. Now, that liberty is different. It doesn't, affirming that liberty claim isn't to affirm a rights correlative obligation to give what's needed for that person to survive. Right? You're following what I'm saying, right? Okay, so someone is at liberty to take this loaf of bread that they need to survive off my kitchen table. They're not obligated under those circumstances to just sit there and die. Someone else is at liberty to take the loaf on behalf of that person, right? I don't have a right that person not take it, but so far, I'm still morally at liberty to whisk it away, right? Do I want to live in a world where we have these types of conflicting liberties? No, I don't want to live in that world. And so it's reasonable for me to get together with other people who would be exposed to these liberties and instead arrange for a place for people who need the food to go and get it.
I want to know whether I'm going to die in this example. So I'm sleepwalking to the window,
yes,
and I'm going to fall to my death.
Yes.
Unless you interpose,
right,
you know, your body between me and the window.
Yes.
You might think that ordinarily you have a reason to do it, but you can't be bothered, so you're not going to do it. I'm going to fall and I'm going to die. Then Pablo turns up and tries to throw your body in between me.
Yes. Yes.
You know, and the window. And
yes,
your claim is that I'm at liberty, if I were in a position, you know,
yes,
so to act, I would be,
yes,
at liberty to do so,
yes,
and I can pass on my liberty to Pablo.
Yes.
Are you at liberty to push him away, to defend yourself against him?
Yes, I am. But, but, but,
well, okay.
But I don't want to be in that position.
Okay.
And the way we avoid being in that position is that those of us who have lots of loaves of bread make the loaves of bread available.
But you only have one body. You only want, you can't split your body in such,
yes,
a way that you have a second body to interpose between me and the window. So,
right,
so
right,
how would you?
There's no. So there is no. I don't have a social institution,
right,
that handles that question.
Right.
Right.
Okay.
You know,
yeah,
there are lots of questions that no one has a social institution to handle.
This may be the last question. Let's see how.
This question is related to the one that you're just discussing. It's also for Eric Mack, and it's about the bullet that you're biting. And I think that when you're biting that bullet, the rescue bullet, you made a move that I'm a little bit concerned about. And I want to distinguish between just, you know, having reasons to do something, and I think Professor Fapp was referring to this, having reasons to do something, having a moral obligation to do something, and then having a moral, this is the third category, having a moral obligation that others justifiably can enforce coercively. Okay, so, and it seems to me that you were evacuating that second possibility, the second category. And I wonder whether if we sort of eliminate or hold at bay for the moment the third, the enforceability issue, the coercive enforceability issue, whether you'd be willing to revise your view on this. So in the case of the rescue, you say, look, I might have good reasons why I should jump in there. And these would be kind of the reasons, well, you know, you'd just be, you'd be a happier person to be the kind of person who jumps in those cases. You know, you'd be admired by other people, appropriately so, for being the kind of guy that you are. And I think you were appealing to that. We admire you now to know that you would rescue this person, and that's probably an appropriate emotional response that we have to you, is admiration. But you seem to want to deny that the other person has a moral right correlative to your moral obligation to do it. And as I say, let's leave aside the coercive enforceability for now. And that seems to suggest that, let's say that the person who was drowning, was going to drown, but then by some fluke accident actually makes it out. That seems to suggest that they have no standing to resent you, to have these kind of reactive attitudes towards you, and to ask for an apology. You would be very surprised if they were having, or at least you'd want to correct their reactive attitudes towards you in this way. Other people wouldn't really have standing to be indignant towards you in this way. And it seems to me that, you know, in the same way that I might have a friend who has made various promises to me that are certainly not enforceable coercively by the legal system, but nevertheless, I might resent them for breaking those promises. Sure. It's not just about you having reasons that would, say, be prudential reasons for you to be admired or whatever. Are you going to hold the line to say that we have no standing to resent or feel indignant towards you for not having saved the child that was drowning?
Yeah. No, if we have the trichotomy that you started with firmly in hand, right, so that speaking the language of obligations and duties does not begin to take us over into obligations for which there are enforceable correlative rights, right? Because we have these three different categories. Then I'm totally happy with saying obligations. It's the fear that it was my sense that we would just have these two alternatives, right? Over here there are obligations which we're almost immediately going to think of as subject and principle to legal enforcement. Am I going to endorse obligations in that sense, or take the only alternative that was given me, talk about reasons, then I'm going to talk about reasons. But if we have these nice three separate categories, I'm completely happy. The next question is, what account do I give of those obligations, right? Because there might be some question about whether I can give a decent account.
And I'll stop, but yeah. The worry is that you've opened the door to the third category, right?
Yeah, I don't think so. I don't think so.
When we adjourn, I'll invite everyone to join us upstairs in the billiard room on the third floor for a reception. I'll remind you, April 13th at 4:30 in the ballroom downstairs is the inaugural lecture for the Jan P. Lin Center, given by Orlando Patterson. If you would like to be kept informed of the public events like this and like the Lin Center inaugural lecture, please go ahead and get in touch with me. I'm Jacob Levy. I can be reached by the usual McGill email for that. I want to ask that before members of the RGCS faculty and postdoc group go upstairs that you join me up here for a moment. And otherwise, we'll see you upstairs. And please join me in thanking Eric Mack and Cécile Fabre.
That was extremely nice.